Iowa, Chicago, and Eastern is a Midwest regional carrier that operates over ex Milwaukee Road rails in Minnesota, Iowa, Missouri, Wisconsin, and Illinois. After the Milwaukee went bankrupt, the Soo Line took over operations in 1985. Canadian Pacific took ownership of the Soo in the early 1990s. CP then spun these lines off to the I&M Rail Link in April of 1997.
After the IMRL experienced financial troubles, the railroad was sold to the Iowa, Chicago, and Eastern in late July of 2002.
In this video, we will highlight IC&E's operations over its entire system.
From Nahant, we'll head north on IC&E's River Subdivision to Sabula.
Two former Burlington Northern SD40-2s are switching out the cars bound for IPSCO Steel in Montpelier, Iowa. These locomotives were leased at startup to replace most of the IMRL's aging fleet of first and second generation road power. At the time this scene was shot in July of 2003, many of the IC&E's newly rebuilt SD40-2s were arriving on the property. As these new units arrived, the FURX units left the property for service elsewhere. This former Southern Pacific SD9 will soon be headed for an elevator in South Dakota.
IMRL 207 has seen better days.
After being stored for several years, IC&E's SD9 number 614 was reactivated in late summer of 2004 and is seen work in the yard in Nahant. Thank you. Two classic GP9s cross underneath Iowa Interstate's main line in downtown Davenport with local number 914. Snaking through the curves along the Mississippi River is train PSPNA. This potash train originated on the Canadian Pacific and is bound for the Iowa Interstate here in Davenport. Late tonight, another crew will transfer the train to the interstate. We're at a location known as Waterworks, where the branch to Mount Joy and Eldridge leaves the main line. We made a trip to Davenport during Grand Excursion 2004.
Grand Excursion celebrated the 150th anniversary of a similar event in 1854.
During late June of 2004, riverboats were everywhere, creating quite a sight for people along the river to see. The race is on as 918 heads north. The train is passing the south siding switch at Bettendorf. The route from Davenport to Clinton was once owned by the Davenport, Rock Island, and Northwestern, which was jointly owned by the Burlington Northern and Canadian Pacific.
The railroads decided to dissolve the dry line in 1995, with the CP getting the trackage in Iowa and the BN getting the trackage in Illinois.
Today, the IC&E and BNSF maintain trackage rights on each other's railroad. This short BENA will meet train 914 here at Pleasant Valley. I-14 now comes north with more former IMRL power. Train 914, with a very friendly crew, passes near milepost 182. We saw quite a few I&M Rail Link signs and stickers throughout our travels, including this one at LeClaire. From LeClaire, the tracks run along the river for the next 5 miles to Princeton. Wildflowers, a former CNW SD40-2, and the river make for a beautiful scene north of LeClaire. One of two SD45s on IC&E's roster powers north. The locomotive is not yet lettered for the IC&E. The train is now traveling at a high rate of speed north of Princeton. South of Comanche, we see the mid-July corn crop is looking very healthy as we wait for local 914. Next, we will cover the Chicago subdivision east from Sabula Junction. From Savanna, the tracks leave the Mississippi River Valley to begin their journey across the rolling farmland of northern Illinois. A very moody and beautiful scene is laid out for us as the moon rises over the still waters along the Sabula Causeway. The 918 locals crew is busy with their nightly work on this muggy summer evening. The Sabula Swing Bridge is now closed, and the 918 gets the signal to come across. Another 918 train pulls to a stop at Savanna for a crew change. 918 runs as a turn, forwarding the MNABR to Savanna and returning with the MBRNA. With the setting sun over the Mississippi River Valley, we patiently wait for the NABR near the top of the hill at Red Barn. In the distance, we hear the train's three SD40-2s pulling hard up the grade. Thank you. With the aid of a GP40, the BNA is underway again after stalling just east of here. East of Kirkland, a classic pair of crossbucks still protect this rural crossing. Train MNABE passes on its way east. Now head back towards the river to follow the Marquette subdivision to La Crescent, Minnesota. The 202 bounces along south of Bellevue. We have arrived in Dubuque, which is the largest city on the Marquette sub. The IC&E shares track with the Canadian National Illinois Central through town. Class unit of IC's SD40s number 6000, along with GT5832, await their next call to duty in front of the yard office as a Kansas City to St. Paul ICE train heads north. Since Dubuque is not the best place to catch high-speed mainline action, we decided to head west one morning to catch IC train M338 charging through the community of Epworth, Iowa. The train is doing its best to stay ahead of an approaching thunderstorm. Back at Dubuque, the monster 130-car train of SPKC we saw earlier departs south. The 202 still looks sharp in its IMRL paint. We now view the location from another vantage point. This overlook is known as Estes Point. From here we will view the SPKC heading south over the Turkey River Bridge. In the distance, the lights of Balltown can be seen nearly 11 miles away. The scenery along this part of the Mississippi Valley is spectacular. IC&E's other SD45, number 363, heads north. We've arrived in Marquette. This is the point where the Mason City sub to Sheldon leaves the river line. Marquette once had a floating pontoon bridge connecting across the river to Prairie du Chien, Wisconsin. The bridge was removed in 1961. These two ACs will be called for train FMCKC late tonight. Continuing north on the Marquette subdivision, we set up north of Harper's Ferry to catch the SPKC heading south. The train is now street running through the town of Lansing. As the sun breaks the horizon, a detoured DM&E train heads north for La Crescent. As part of the grand excursion, the Milwaukee Road 261 made plenty of trips on the IC&E during June of 2004. Here we see it approaching La Crescent. Just up the hill from River Junction, a strange sight catches our eye. Hundreds of shoes hang from trees along the highway. Later that day, a La Crosse news crew even showed up to videotape the shoes. From River Junction, IC&E trains operate via trackage rights on the Canadian Pacific's River Subdivision to St. Paul. We see the westbound signal at Minnesota City East is lined for the approaching KCSP. At Whitman, CP train 291 heads west with two Sioux SD60s. One of the best spots for train watching on the River Sub is at Maple Springs. Here the tracks run along a causeway, making for a nice scene of another KCSP. In the distance, sounds of the Burlington Northern can be heard as FURX-led SPKC approaches our location. We now pace alongside the train on Highway 61 through Frontenac. In Hastings, the train is crossing onto the Mississippi River Lift Bridge and will soon reach the end of the river subdivision at St. Croix Junction. Now on the joint tracks of the CP and BNSF, the crew of this KCSP is only a few miles away from the end of their run at St. Paul Yard. Next, we will move to the old Iowa and Dakota mainline, now the Mason City subdivision from Sheldon to Marquette, Iowa. We will begin by covering the western half of the line from Sheldon to Mason City. The nearly 90-year-old 90-pound jointed rail and trains stopping to pick up grain in the small towns along the route gives this line a traditional flavor. We will see grain locals 940 and 942 working the line. In search of trains, a thick fog was encountered here at Cylinder, Iowa. A cut of grain cars waits to be picked up late tonight by the 940. We move west to Everly to wait for local 942. A friend has worked its way east, and most of the fog is now dissipated. The crew is headed to work CF Industries east of town. The crew has completed their work and is now back in Everly, but it looks as if the elevator workers have not quite finished loading the grain cars scheduled to be picked up today. So the decision was made to tie the train down until the 940's crew comes on duty later tonight. On another day, we did catch the 940 departing east. We've arrived in Spencer. This is a crew change point for the regularly scheduled 940 and 942s on this line. 940's train has just arrived from Mason City. The crew is already uncoupled from their train and has gone off duty. The 222 is a former Chicago and Northwestern locomotive inherited from the Chicago Great Western. A P5 air horn can be seen atop of the 222. The 8 a.m. 942's crew has arrived and begins their day's work. On a normal day, the 942 would make a turn to Sheldon, but today a last-minute change of plans means the train will head back east into the morning sun with the 222. On another day, the 940 finishes a little work before departing Spencer. The train is now waiting at the yard limit board for a track warrant to depart east. A beautiful, surreal scene is captured just as the 940 throttles up to head east. With the train needed in Mason City before 1 in the morning to beat a work window on Kalmar Hill, the engineer isn't wasting any time. The 942 we saw in Spencer heads east to work Ruthven, Emmitsburg, and Whittemore. With crickets chirping, the 940 begins its work at Ruthven. The 942 now heads light to Whittemore. We now take a quick look back to March of 2002 to see IMRL's 940 pulling hard out of cylinder. Now running as train number 940 and with a new crew on board, we pace alongside the 222 on its way east to Mason City. The train will return to join the rail after passing the next crossing. At Hutchins, grain cars bound for the Kansas City Southern wait to be picked up by Local 942. Iowa is extremely rich with agriculture, as these closely spaced elevators attest. 942 arrives and makes the pickup. In the town of Britt, an old Milwaukee Road boxcar is displayed in a city park. Britt hosts an annual celebration dedicated to hobos and was featured in a National Geographic 1984 documentary, Love Those Trains. A wind farm makes for an interesting backdrop for another 940. This location between Britt and Garner is known as Duncan. East of Gardner, this old semaphore signal guards the approach to the crossing of a Union Pacific branch line in town. During the summer of 2004, IC&E ran a special train for its employees and their families. On a cold, windy November day, two former Burlington Northern SD40-2s pull hard past the semaphore.
We will now cover the northern half of the Owatonna subdivision from Comus to Austin. During Canadian Pacific and IMRL days, this section of track saw little use. Under IC&E's ownership, the line south of Owatonna now sees long, heavy mainline trains operating to and from sister railroad Dakota, Minnesota, and Eastern. This route hasn't seen this much traffic since the days of the Milwaukee Road. In the spring of 2004, the Progressive Rail took over Union Pacific's industrial trackage in Faribault, as well as the Cannon Falls Spur. To reach industries in Faribault, the Progressive Rail uses IC&E's track from Comus to Faribault. The train is just north of Comus on Union Pacific's spine line. The train is now just south of the junction at Comus on the IC&E heading to Faribault. These sharp-looking boxcars are headed to Faribault Foods. In Owatonna, we found a classic pair of Griswold crossing signals on DM&E's main line west of Owatonna Junction. This train is bound for interchange with the IC&E at Austin. The train will travel over 30 miles on IC&E's Owatonna subdivision before arriving in Austin. Unfortunately, we returned a few weeks later to find the Griswolds replaced by new LED-equipped crossing flashers. The crew of the 952 local has stopped in Blooming Prairie to get some ice cream at the Dairy Queen. The red and white Dairy Queen matches their locomotive, a red and white GP9. In Ramsey, we set up near a waterfall along the line to wait for the 952 local. While we were waiting, we heard a little wildlife. Listen closely as we hear the hooting of an owl over the sound of the waterfall. Thank you.
From Ramsey, we will head west to Wells on the Jackson subdivision. This line was rebuilt with funds from the state of Minnesota in the final years of the Milwaukee, with many new ties, ballast, and most importantly, heavy welded rail. The work has paid off since trains can still travel at speeds up to 40 miles per hour over the line. The Wells Local is working through the rolling hills west of Austin as the train approaches our location in the tiny community of Oakland. Wells Local crosses under Interstate 90 west of Armstrong. The crew of this 948 is nearing the end of their workday as they approach Wells. In Wells, we see the power for today's train parked next to the former Milwaukee Road Depot. Just as the day comes to an end in downtown Wells, the yard sits quiet for the night in preparation for another day's work. Back in Austin, we set up for southbound train number 944, heading to Norris Springs.
In Austin, the Minnesota Department of Public Safety resides in the former Milwaukee Road Depot.
The Milwaukee Road sign is fully displayed on the building in remembrance of the railroad that once served Austin. Thank you. Now we will follow the east end of the Mason City subdivision from Mason City to Marquette. We've arrived at the Mason City Yard. It is a very important facility for the corn lines. The yard originates and terminates trains from the west, north, and east. The 105 was stored during this visit, but by August of 2004, the unit was again being operated. Engineer Craig Williams gives his five locomotives one last notch as his train climbs the grade out of Norris Springs. Fishermen enjoy a relaxing evening by the water as an eastbound passes the town of Rudd. Signs of the IMRL's existence can still be found at many places across the system.
A gopher pops up along the worn-out jointed rail that once covered Calmer Hill.
At the same location a year later, we find that new welded rail has recently been installed. Last, we will cover the Kansas City subdivision. South of Nahant to Washington, Iowa, the ice uses former Rock Island trackage. This is the longest section of the IC&E's rail line not originally owned by the Milwaukee Road. South of Ottumwa, the tracks leave the prairie behind and enter southern Iowa's hill country.
The scenic highlights of the line are the Foster Bridges, which are located in the hilly terrain south of Ottumwa. The last 42 miles of track from Polo to Airline Junction in Kansas City is joint trackage with the Union Pacific.
IC&E's yard in Kansas City is Kanokie Yard, which is shared with the Kansas City Southern. Unaware of an approaching train, a mother and her fawn hang out on the tracks near Montpelier. This location is on the lead to IPSCO Steel. This IPSCO plant was the first new plate mill to start up in the United States since Bethlehem Steel opened its Burns Harbor, Indiana plate mill in the 1960s.
As the train departs to the plant, we view a section of the lead that was cut through the hilly terrain when the line was built specifically for the mill's rail traffic in the mid-1990s. Trains tackle a steep grade from the main line to the mill.
Train MNAKC is an extra manifest run from Nahant to Kansas City. We found this old grain structure in the small community of Farson, Iowa. Train FMCKC is a feed train from the Corn Lines that runs from Mason City to interchange with the Kansas City Southern at Kenoke Yard in Kansas City. We're set up next to one of the spectacular Foster Bridges between Blakesburg and Moravia. Local 930 crosses the bridge with ballast for a project in Moravia. This was the only train that crossed the bridges in daylight hours on this day. End our journey at the IC&E, we head to West Central Illinois along the Mississippi River to capture the 910 local. This train operates on BNSF rails as a part of the agreement of the breakup of the Davenport, Rock Island, and Northwestern. We catch this local a couple times as it approaches Moline. Throughout the time we spent shooting this video, we have come to appreciate the people, the trains, and the land through which they operate. By making wise investments in some parts of the railroad and economies in others, the Iowa, Chicago, and Eastern has secured their system's viability for many years to come.